back a few weeks later and thought, what the hell was I doing putting 80 hours of my life into that? That usually happens because the game used Skinner's techniques to create the illusion of engagement and extend playtime. RPGs, especially poorly made ones, are a great example of this. Everything from loot drops to leveling is a very clear reward schedule that reinforces the behavior that gets you the reward. Ever been playing late, getting sleepy, but then decide that you can get just one more level before you go to bed?
But,
yeah. But this isn't just an RPG problem.
Sorry,
it's epic. Almost anything with points uses this system. Ask your grandmother sometime why she plays so much in Duel. But it goes beyond points, too. It works with anything that has a clear and manifest reward. Solitaire, the most played game in the world, sets up the infrequent win as a clear reward. Many action games use the same system to convince players to mash the same buttons for 12 hours straight. Even elements like the voiceovers and shooters that tell the player how awesome they are can be used as finishing tools. It's also one of the main reasons every game is getting RPG elements these days. Now, don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with adding RPG elements if it's being used to create deep, immersive systems for the game. I'm actually a huge fan of this trend when it's used to combine mental challenges and execution challenges like in Call of Duty or Dungeon Fighter. But too many games are using RPG elements as a crutch. Bland, uninspired games will include reward systems simply to delay your realization of what they're doing. My point is, there are other, better ways of fostering engagement, and those are the members we should be demanding from our games, not simple Skinner box satisfaction. Here are a few examples. One, mystery. Human curiosity is a powerful thing. We like unraveling mysteries. We've all played a game that made us ask, what the hell is going on? Immediately followed by, how many people are there? Two, mastery. Player can be engaged by giving him the opportunity to master a skill and then utilize that mastery. We see this sort of thing in rhythm games, fighting games, sometimes even RPGs.
Yeah.
Hold on, chef.
Hold on, chef.
For game design, it's probably one of the first things they'll teach you. But why don't we use this for almost every part of our games, from spotting out the levels to figuring out the overall arc of the game? We've got no analogous concept for the social side of play. When you get down to it, though, the challenge is whether it's mechanical or social. And I've clearly seen games fail because their social play deviates wildly from that curve. So let's talk about this, because as we create games which involve interpersonal interaction, it's important to recognize that a player's skill within the social framework of a game increases over time. Let's take MMOs as an example. If you are anything like me, you start out just playing solo. Periodically form pickup groups and begin to
this will be better, and then you
next,
can remove
you start
the green
adding people to your friends list. Soon you've got a group you adventure with semi-regularly, and you find yourself
and then
using
the some,
all the time to make money,
you know,
to put together
good.
Complex ingredient chains you need
without,
to craft it. Then, as you get to your level cap, you join a guild and you start to take on multi-part raids. And hey, if you're a more active player than I usually am, maybe you finally step up to do the heavy lifting and actually run a guild.
Oh, don't worry. We did that in Premiere. It's really easy. Same with
you
doing here. Once I've done the video, we'll add songs. This time we'll actually.